Hi, this is COMP1010 at the University of Manitoba. I'm Dr. Celine Latulip, and today I'm going to talk to you about the char primitive data type. So the char type is used to hold a single character, as opposed to strings, which hold a collection of characters. It's usually one byte in older programming languages, but in processing, it occupies two bytes. So here's the syntax of a char variable. It's very similar to other primitive data types that you've seen. You have the data type name, char, and then whatever variable name you give following standard variable naming, camel case, etc. And then you initialize it by giving it a single character inside of single quotes. So it's important that you use single quotes and not double quotes, because double quotes is used to initialize strings, right? So if you look at this example, this X in single quotes is a char. This X that's in double quotes is actually a string that just happens to only have one character in it. So a single character that can be stored in a char could be a letter, small letter, capital letter. It could be a digit. It could be some kind of symbol or a space. And there's lots of other things that could be stored in a char. There isn't actually an empty character the way there is an empty string with strings. So if you actually needed a single quote as your character, you need to use the escape sequence. So we've seen this before. You use a backslash and then the single char, and that would give you a single quotation mark as your character. So one of the things to note is that computers actually store characters as numbers. So char, even though you think of it as some kind of character, it's actually a numeric type. And so when it's used as a number, it kind of automatically becomes an integer. So you can use integer arithmetic operations on characters like plus and minus. That doesn't necessarily always make a lot of sense, but it's in some cases you can do this. So every character is represented by a numeric code. In old computing, the numeric code was ASCII, and ASCII is still around. It's really common, but ASCII only gave you a very small set of characters. And so that's why actually characters originally were really only needed one byte to be stored. Nowadays, we typically see something like Unicode, which has like 65,000 characters or more, can handle lots of different characters from lots of different languages all at once. And this is why we typically take two bytes or 16 bits. And Unicode includes ASCII as the first set of characters in it. So often you'll be able to see ASCII codes that work in Unicode. So this is like a picture of the ASCII table. And you can see here that like capital A is 65, capital T is 84, small p is 112, etc. And the numbers are in here as well. So 0 is 48. 9 is 57. So these are the way that you could actually think about a char as actually being a number. So if you've got the char capital T, the number that's stored is actually 84. Now, you do not need to memorize this table. This table can be Googled at any time. It's just you should understand that this thing exists, right? So one of the things to know is how big the data type is. And you've seen this diagram before that I've shown you that talks about where you can do conversions automatically and where you have to do casts. So when you're going from a small type into a big type, that's a widening conversion, an implicit cast that the system can do for you. But when you're trying to take a big type and stuff it into a smaller type, you have to do an explicit cast. And char is the smallest type we've seen so far. Okay, so in this case, if we have the letter C as a character, and we're trying to put it into an int X, well, that works fine because char is smaller and we can put it into an int. And so if the character code that's being used is ASCII, this would store 99 in X. Right. You can sort of also do it the same, the other direction. So if you have an integer like 65, then you know, and you store it in char C. Well, 65 is the capital letter A in the ASCII table, right? And so this could be problematic because you might think that you're gonna get A, but if ASCII is not the character set that's being used, you could get something different, right? And you can also see how you could sort of do some arithmetic with this. So in this case, if we had done char C equals 65 and we put we think we've got A in char C, and then we add 3 to it, it adds 3 to 65, it's 68, and then that becomes a D. Now you have to then cast this, because these become integers, you have to cast it as a char into C. So that's a narrowing conversion to get it into the char data type. So these are sort of examples of how you might use characters and integers in sort of an interchangeable way. And the code for some characters makes sense. So the code for A to Z are 26 consecutive numbers from 65 to 90. If you've got ASCII, right? For small a to small z, you've got 97 to 122, and the digits 0 to 9 are 48 to 57. So you can use this information to do something like change a character from uppercase to lowercase. So say we've got an uppercase character, it's capital N, and we want the lowercase version of that. We can take lowercase a and add our character N, minus uppercase a, which basically gives us the offset in the capital alphabet. We add that offset to the small alphabet, and lower should then become lowercase n. So, and again, we need this cast of a char to put this integer operation into a smaller type. So don't memorize these numbers and sets. And really, in general, we don't recommend you use numbers in this way at all. And the reason is that if your program is going to be translated into other languages and other cultures, it may not be ASCII and Unicode that's being used, it could be other things, and then this stuff will actually cause your program to break, and you don't want that, okay? All right, there's some built-in functions, just like with built-in functions for strings, there's built-in functions for characters that are important to know about. So for example, Boolean character.isLetter, and you pass in a char, and this will return true if it's an uppercase or a lowercase letter, and it will return false otherwise. So in this case, if char x equals k, and we call character is letter of x and assign the result to this is a letter, then this is a letter would actually become true because k is a letter. If char x was actually the plus sign, then this is a letter would become false. All right. There's also is uppercase, which is sort of a more specific version. Is it an uppercase letter? There's is lowercase, of course. And there's also is digit. So if you need to know if a character held a digit from 0 to 9, then you can use this. And there's a whole bunch more. So you can Google the Java character class to find out more if you're interested. Now, a few of you may be like, wait a second, this dot notation, we've seen it before, but I thought chars were primitives, and I thought we weren't supposed to use dot notation on chars. And so we're using the dot notation here in a little bit of a different way. So the dot notation in this case is being called on character, which is an object class. This isn't a variable, this is a whole class of characters, and it's what we call a wrapper class that can be used to make primitives into objects. This is a static call, so we don't need to call this method on an object. We're passing in the object that we want to work on instead. So you don't really need to worry about this. If you notice that this seemed like, wait a second, if you notice that this was, we're working with chars, which are primitives, and we're using this dot notation, and that question came to you, congratulations, you're following along well, and you're asking the right questions. In a later programming class, you'll learn more about this type of thing where we're calling a method on an actual class or object name, not an object variable. All right, you can convert from a character into a string. And the way that we do that is using the str command. So you've seen the str command already. You've seen us convert numbers and other things into a string, and this works the same way. So char c equals lowercase m, and we create a string s, and we do str of c, and that would put m as the first character in the string s, but it would put that would be a string, which would be a collection of characters which just happen to only have one character. You can also add a character to the empty string. So this is using our concatenation operator, and that looks like this. So again, char c equals lowercase m, and then we do string s equals the empty string plus c. And remember that when we have a string and we concatenate it with a character, when we concatenate a string with anything, that thing is automatically turned into a string. So this would give us a string with the letter C in it. All right. How do you work with this stuff in processing in terms of user input? So you've already probably seen that the Boolean variable keyPressed allows you to tell if somebody's pressing a key on the keyboard, okay? And so the question then is, how do you know which key was pressed and can we use that information? Well, of course we can. So the built-in processing variable key tells us which key on the keyboard was most recently pressed, and it is a char variable. So here's an example. So if we have an if statement where we're checking if a key was pressed, we can then have further if-else statements that check which key. So this one says if key equals lowercase r or if key equals uppercase r, then we change our stroke color to red. Here, if key equals lowercase b or key equals uppercase b, then we're going to change our stroke color to blue, etc. So this is one way that you can use the keys from the keyboard to get input from the user and do something, you know, interesting with it. It's important to note that this construct here, if you put this inside draw, it's going to respond multiple times to each key press, because when a user presses a key on a keyboard, they don't press it for a 60th of a second. They hold it down for maybe, you know, a 10th of a second. And so that could have this called 10 times inside draw. And so you'd be repeatedly setting the stroke color to red because the person had let their finger linger on the R key just for a 10th of a second. All right, so one way to handle this instead so that you're not repeatedly doing this stuff is to use the void keyPressed function. So this is similar to the mouse clicked function, and this will only be called once, and then you can put the same code inside of there to check which key was pressed and do something appropriate. Okay, so that's everything for characters and chars and using the key variable in processing. Thanks for watching.